Hello, God bless you, and welcome to the House of His Glory. I am Pastor Deidre Campbell Jones, and welcome to 2019. If you are watching this on Sunday morning through our iChurchForLife.churchonline.org platform on Sunday, January 6th, then you are watching this fresh and brand new for this first Sunday of January, this first Sunday of 2019. This is our 2019 Prophetic Consecration Service. Welcome. If you are watching on demand or you are watching at any other time, this is our special prophetic word that God has for us going forward in 2019. And so whenever you are tuning in, welcome, thank you. If you are tuning in, this word is for you. No matter when you are watching it, it will never be too late to receive this word and begin walking in this word. So let's get right to it and praise God for this word. Let's go before Him in this first congregational prayer of the new year. Join me. Will you turn your hearts towards the Lord in prayer and in agreement with me? Father God, we thank you so much for 2019, for bringing us into this new year. Father God, we thank you so much for bringing us through 2018, through all the ups and downs, the highs and lows, the trials, the tribulations, the joys, the strengths, the things we learned, the things we endured. Father, thank you for being with us, for promising never to leave us or forsake us. You have been faithful to your word in our lives throughout 2018, and we look forward to all that you have for us this year and going forward. Father, I thank you for everyone who watched, who listened, who participated, who learned, who gave, who shared, who agreed with everything you did in this ministry in 2018. I thank you for every visitor, for every member, for every partner of this ministry. I thank you for friends and family. I thank you, Heavenly Father, most of all, for every lesson that we learned, that we were able to apply, that strengthened us, encouraged us, prospered us, provided for us, and taught us how to be conformed in the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. I thank you now, Heavenly Father, for everyone who is watching or listening. I thank you that because I know, Father God, that this word today is a word that will not only strengthen their individual lives, it's a word that will not only draw them closer to you, but it is a word that begins to build them as the church of Jesus Christ. I thank you, Heavenly Father, for every blessing and promise that you have for us this year, Father God. I thank you for every healing. I thank you for every gift of favor. I thank you for every blessing. I thank you for every provision. I thank you for every act of prosperity that you intend to work in our lives. I thank you for making us the righteousness of God in Christ and for helping us to see the fullness of what that means to us as your children. Father God, I thank you right now for this word that you have for us. I am so excited and grateful that you are using me as your vessel to deliver this word, as your oracle of this word. And so, Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus Christ that you would remove, help us to remove, to not be swayed or distracted by any spirit that would keep us from this word, that there would be no hindrances, obstacles, or barriers that would keep us from receiving this word. Heavenly Father, I thank you right now for giving us the spirit of revelation, the knowledge of understanding your word. Father, I thank you right now for giving us clarity, insight, and wisdom through this word to see our lives and to see our purpose in the earth through Christ Jesus. I thank you right now in the mighty, glorious, matchless, perfect, beautiful name of Jesus Christ. We give you all praise and glory, and we pray this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. Amen. And God bless you for agreeing with me in this prayer. Today is our prophetic consecration service, which means we are going to consecrate this year. That means set it aside unto holiness and set it aside for the purpose that God has for us through his prophetic word. But it is also our Melchizedek service. We are going to offer the first fruits of our blessing and prosperity unto the Lord today through our tithes and offering, and we are going to go into our communion portion of the service right after this song of praise. So please gather together your elements, your juice, your wine, your water, your crackers, bread, whatever you have. Maybe not wine, but if that's what you've got, let's prepare our elements as we also prepare our hearts for communion through this song of praise. And we will be right back afterwards. God bless you.
Rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am when oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours.
God bless you, and thank you for joining me back for this communion portion of our Melchizedek service for this first Sunday of 2019. I want to start by reading to you John 7, chapter 7, starting at verse 53. And Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoso eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood dwells in me and I in him. Praise God. Praise God. Jesus is saying that when we partake of communion, of the elements of the bread and the wine, the juice, we take unto ourselves eternal life, the newness of life. And so whether you have received Jesus as your Savior already or not, now is the time to make that decision for Jesus Christ, that you can come to Him and receive Him as your Lord and Savior, declaring that He is the Son of God and that you believe that God raised Him from the dead, and that by taking of His of the bread, you take of his flesh, and by taking of the cup, you take of his blood that gives us all new life in him. When it was the Last Supper, that we call it, that last Passover that Jesus shared with his disciples, he said unto them, he took the bread, and he said unto them, This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat, and do so in remembrance of me. And so we take the bread now, and we do as he did, and we say, Thank you, Father, that this is the body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We take this bread, discerning his body and all that his body did for us, and we do so in remembrance of him. And likewise, he took the cup, and in lifting it to heaven, he said, This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. He told us that this cup held the remission of our sins. And so we take now and we do as he did, and we say, Thank you that this is the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And that through his blood, we are redeemed. We are cleansed from all unrighteousness. And we take and we drink and we do so in remembrance of him until the Lord's return. Thank you for joining me in this communion portion of our service. Heavenly Father, I thank you for everyone who joined me in communion. Father, thank you for eternal life, the newness of life that you have promised us through Jesus Christ. All that you have promised through his body and through his blood, we give you thanks now in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you for sticking around, for joining me back for this message in our 2019 prophetic consecration service. I call it this prophetic consecration service because this is the time of the year where I have always, even when I was a minister on staff since the Family Church International, where I have taken this time of the year to go before the Lord and just seek His presence and seek His purpose for my life as an individual, not even necessarily as a minister or a pastor, but just to seek God for what He had for me coming up in that next year. And it seemed that God always, not it seemed, but He did always give me a prophetic word that said, this is the year and what I have for you going forward in this year. And you know, I would share that at times. He put it on my heart who to share that with. But then as I have entered into my calling as a pastor of this ministry, I've carried on this tradition, so to speak, in my life, and seeing how it applies to the congregation that God has called me to lead. And so specifically, each year, this prophetic word that God gives me is one that is specific and particular to everyone who is a member of this congregation, who aligns themselves with the teaching of this congregation, or who hears this prophetic word and receives it as a word that connects with their spirit, a word that they recognize that God is giving to them as well. And so we consecrate then our lives according to that prophetic word, meaning this is the first fruits of all we intend to learn and do and worship and praise the Lord for going forward, that we will set aside this word as holy. That's what it means to be consecrated, to be set aside as holy. And we declare and decree right now that this is the holy word of God, His rhema word, the oracle of God for our lives, directly from His heart through my mouth to all of us. This is the word of the Lord that He has given me. And so at this time, I ask you to join me in hearing this word and receiving this word as it applies to us as individuals and as His church, the house of His glory. And one of the most unique things about this word this year is that I kind of, with the holidays and Christmas time, in visiting with family and friends, especially over New Year's, it was a haphazard time of prayer and seeking the Lord for this word, in which, you know, usually I set aside some time. Sometimes I've been able to go on a sort of a retreat or mini sabbatical, or at least fast and you know, go deep into the word. And last year, the word just came quickly. As soon as I turned my heart to the Lord, He just downloaded it. And this time it's like, oh, you know, it came in little pieces, little snatches of thought that I thought, okay, when I get a chance to go before the Lord and pray about this word, we'll see if that's what the word is that He has for us, or if He downloads another word. And as it came time then to prepare for today's message, it's like, all I had time to do was just go into a quick prayer, and it was as if God said, I've already given you the word. All of those pieces and snatches of information and thought that I'd had, he had already been filling me with his word for this year, 2019. And it is a word that he wants us to not just adopt, as I said, I've said for the last 2 years, not just for 2019, but for going forward. And so this year, what God has for us is new life. So here's the word that God gave to me. And excuse me if I'm reading, because, you know, I just start writing. I guess that's what he put in me as a writer. And as his word comes to me, I write it down. And so without missing any portion of what he's given, I may at times read it from just the handwritten pages in which he has given it to me. And so first and foremost, God sees the church as both individual beings and as a collective of individual churches. So when the scriptures speak of the church, God has sort of a dual vision of what that means. He sees us as individuals, but as individuals, we make up the church collective, okay? And so then we as Christians say that we are the church. We are speaking the truth both as individuals and as the whole church body of Christ. Why is this important? Because this word of new life that God is speaking to us this year is based in the parable of the 10 virgins in Matthew chapter 25. And Matthew chapter 25, starting at verse 1, talks about the parable of the 10 virgins. And they took their lamps and prepared to go out to meet the bridegroom. Now, if you know anything about this story, you know that this story, this parable, is steeped in Jewish culture surrounding a bride and the bridegroom and the way in which they would prepare for the marriage feast. And so the 10 virgins or maids or attendants of the bride took their lamps and were waiting in one place for the bridegroom to come and take them to the marriage feast. And as they are waiting in this place, you know, and the parable says that morning and night, you know, it's several days, and as time goes on, five of the virgins realize that their lamps are out of oil, and they are called the five foolish virgins. But the five wise virgins had prepared and brought extra oil. Well, the five foolish virgins, who are now their lamps, their wicks have gone out, and there's an announcement that the bridegroom is soon to come. And so in desperation, they tell the wise virgins, give us some of your oil. But the wise virgins are like, forget it. Go out to the marketplace and buy your own oil. And sure enough, as the five foolish virgins go out to buy more oil, in the midst of their absence, the bridegroom comes, taking the five wise virgins into the place of the marriage feast, and the door is shut against the foolish virgins who come back too late, so to speak. And so God sees us in this parable as both the individuals who are exampled as the virgins, but also as churches, individual churches who are exampled in the five foolish and the five wise virgins. And most theologians agree that this parable is one of the church, that it's speaking of the churches in the last days when Jesus will come and return for his bride and rapture the church. And so in this parable, there is this space of time when all of them are together, all of them have their lamps, all of them are waiting for the return of the bridegroom, right? But five of the virgins come to this place of recognition where they realize they no longer have oil in their vessels, in their lamps. And so as individuals, we can represent those vessels, whether as individual beings or as individual churches. There's an aspect of us that is represented by those vessels. We, in fact, are described biblically as vessels. And so let me give you some examples of us being described as vessels. Romans 9 and 23 calls us vessels of mercy, that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he has afore prepared unto his glory. Okay? And 2 Corinthians 4 and 7 says that we are earthen vessels, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. And then we know that it's 1 Peter 3 and 7 admonishes the husbands to treat their wives as the weaker vessel, okay? And then 2 Timothy 2 and 21 says that we shall be vessels of honor. And it's describing aspects of vessels. Some are for dishonor, but if we purge that aspect from our lives, it says that every one of you, well, it says, if a man purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, prepared unto every good work. Now let me say a couple of things about that, because sanctified is another word related to being consecrated. So not only is this prophetic word consecrated and made holy, set aside for God's purpose throughout this year and in our lives going forward, but we are consecrated, we are sanctified. Now, when we're born again, our spirits are instantly sanctified, instantly holy, instantly made perfect. But our souls go through a sanctification process. And so that's what it's saying. If you purge yourself of those aspects which will make your vessel a vessel of dishonor, then you shall be made a vessel of honor. Meet for the master's use. That means made able, a match for the master's use, prepared unto every good work. And I wanted to bring that specific word to your attention because this past week I have done a Bible study related to this word, this prophetic word, that goes into greater detail, much greater detail about not only the parable of the 10 virgins, but also into the specifics of the newness of life that God has for us and it pertains to, part of it pertains to the good work that he wants us to do in the earth. And then finally, the last verse that I want to bring to your attention that talks about us being a vessel is 1 Thessalonians 4:4, that admonishes us to possess our vessel with honor. He says that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and in honor. We are earthen vessels. We are vessels that are a part of this earth. You know, we're created from the dust, but we are a vessel, and vessels can are built, created to contain something. The first verse says that we're a vessel of mercy. It has been prophesied that I particularly am a vessel of God's glory, but all members of the house of his glory are consecrated and ordained to be vessels of his glory. And because of that we as individuals make up the church then becomes a vessel of God, a vessel unto God, a vessel of his purpose, that we are to contain his purpose in the earth. And like a lamp or a vase or a pitcher, we are to pour out that which God has put into us as individuals and as the church. And so in Matthew 25:1, it says that those 10 individuals were prepared to wait for the bridegroom, right? And so they all took their lamps in that preparation. And so God is looking at Christians, and he's looking at the church as individuals who all have their lamps, who are all beginning to prepare for the bridegroom. So what is our lamp? What is our vessel as individual Christians, or as individual churches, or Christians who make up the church of God? First and foremost, it starts with our belief in Jesus Christ. We all have our lamps. We all, as Christians, as believers, have our belief in Jesus Christ, right? We all have our salvation, our forgiveness of sin. We have confessed Jesus as our Lord and Savior, as that common similarity. Like I said, the 10 virgins had those, they all had their lamps, right? And their lamps all had oil within their lamps. Oil, symbolically throughout all the Bible, usually stands for the anointing of the Lord, the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And if you have your vessel, your belief in Jesus Christ, it is filled with that oil. We are filled with the anointing. We are filled with the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. That's our commonality amongst us all. And the third commonality amongst us is our access to the Word of God. Whether we all have the same access, we all should have the same access. Of course, there are countries where Christians are limited and even persecuted for their beliefs, but God is still able to get his word to us through his scriptures, through teachings, through churches, through our pastors. That is the commonality amongst Christians, our belief, our forgiveness, our salvation, and access to his truth, to his word. Amen. But How many of us are waiting on Jesus, waiting on his return, waiting until we go on to that sweet by and by, and we are just waiting with only the oil that's in our lamps, meaning we are waiting on Jesus with just that first indwelling of the Holy Spirit, or with just that first touch of his presence, where we are surviving on our first love, right? And that first understanding of the truth of our salvation. And then how many of us then have come prepared with the ability to refuel, to fill up, to refill, to rejoice, to refuel with fresh oil, with fresh anointing, with fresh purpose, with new power, and with new life, with the newness of life as we go through the sanctification process from faith to faith, from glory to glory, line upon line, precept upon precept, as we grow, as we mature, as we learn the deeper things of God, as we apply the truth of God's word, and we mature as from the milk of God's word into the meat of God's word. How many of us are truly striving and working towards that newness of life on a daily basis? God's word says that his mercies are new every morning. And yet many of us are of Christians, as Christians, are living on our original mercy, our original salvation that saved us from sin, and we're just happy that we're no longer walking in the muck and mire and unrighteousness of our former lives. Well, God is looking towards those who are not forsaking their first love, their first passion, their first desire. He's looking towards those who are not forsaking the church and leaving the church, like those five foolish virgins who had to go out from the place where they were waiting for the bridegroom to go seek the merchants to buy new oil. And so there are individuals now who are separating themselves from the church, and there are churches who are separating themselves from the faith and from the doctrine of the apostles, as scripture says. They are separating themselves from the truth of the pure, unadulterated word of God. And there are individuals who are separating themselves from the anointing of God. They're looking outside the church for what is no longer in that church or even in themselves. Let me say that again. Far too many Christians, they might be called rogue Christians, or in the past we called them church hoppers. Now they're not even church hopping. They might be internet hopping, just going from one sort of looky-loo, haphazard ministry online, you know, flaky Jake. They could be saying anything. They've got no credentials. You don't even know about their salvation. They might be teaching and speaking from their experiences, and people are being fed off of that. It's not even being fed off of McDonald's. It's just being fed off of, you know, ding-dongs and ho-hos. Sorry. They're looking outside of the construct of the church for that which is no longer able to be found in the church or within themselves. Hebrews 10 and 25 says, "Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching." If you have tuned in or listened to the last Bible studies prior to vacation, the final two regarding the rapture. You know, you might see the title of those two Bible studies and things, think that's too heavy. That's probably, you know, Revelations. But those Bible studies were great. And we broke down the truth of the rapture and the tribulation in a way in which it's easy to comprehend. It's easy to understand. And it's not fearful, but gave us hope. Those of us, it gave us an excitement to look forward to what God has in store for us, especially in regards to the rapture. And in those lessons, we learned how to recognize the signs that the day is indeed fastly, quickly approaching. And so today is the day. Now is the time. 2019 and going forward is the season in which we can look around and clearly see that the day of the Lord's return is quickly approaching. And so these are the days to not forsake gathering together as the church. These are the days that we should not be rogue Christians, that we should not be out trying to feed ourselves by anything that tickles our funny bone and reaches our spirit as if, oh, that's right and this right, and I'll take a little piece of this like it's a buffet of truth that we're going to just go online and nourish ourselves by anything that we happen to think feels right, sounds right, looks right, and entertains us. And this is the time where we need to come together as a church, come together in the church, and be in that place together and on one accord, where we are filling our lamps, filling our vessels, where we are come prepared to receive what the Lord has for us, and that we are coming together learning how to be prepared to be the church that Jesus is coming back for. Part of what God is looking forward to, as he's looking for individuals who will make up that church that Jesus will come back for, is found in Hebrews 10, 19 and 20. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil, which is his flesh. Hallelujah. As we went through our communion portion of the service, I read to you that Jesus said if we eat of his flesh and drink of his blood, we will receive eternal life. That we receive life by drinking of his blood and eating of his flesh. His flesh is the veil that was torn for us to walk into the newness of life. This verse says a new and living way, but we can also rephrase that to a new way of living. Hallelujah. And so God has consecrated a new way of living for us by the blood of Jesus Christ through the veil, which is his flesh. So as we come to communion, as we partake of his blood and partake of his flesh, we are partaking of the newness of life, the new way of life that he has consecrated for us, that he has set aside for us, that he has made holy for us. And now is the time that we can enter into that new way of life. Why? Because now is the time that as we see the day approaching, we know we can no longer come to God with timidity and with shyness and with apologies for being wretched individuals or lowly sinners saved by grace or filthy rags. It's time for us to come to God and into His presence with boldness. See, the holiest was that place in the temple and in the tabernacle, which was the holiest of holiests. It was that place where only the high priest could go once a year. It was that place where God resided and abided, where the cloud of smoke by day and the pillar of fire by night rested and abided. When the children of God were in the wilderness, the Israelites were wandering those 40 years in the wilderness, they moved when the cloud moved. They moved when the pillar of fire moved. And they were moving within an area, a dimensional space that if they had gone from point A to point B, it maybe would have only taken them weeks. But instead, because of their complaints, because of their unwillingness to trust God, because of their unwillingness to set aside that old life, to set aside those old ways, to set aside that slave mentality, they were wandering in the desert until those that could not let go of the old way had died in the wilderness, so that those who could receive the newness of life, the promises of God, the blessings of God, the promised land, could walk into that new that newness of life that He had prepared for them. Amen. And so when we read in the scriptures, the Old Testament, that says, if you will humble yourself and turn from your wicked ways and pray, those verses apply to the Old Testament children of God who did not have a way of salvation, who did not have a way of removing their sin and connecting them back to God. But because we, as children of the Most High God, who have come to Him through Jesus Christ, who tore that veil through His flesh and washed us clean of all unrighteousness through our blood, we now have the ability to come to Him with boldness. Amen. To hold our heads high, to hold ourselves with pride as children of the Most High, and come into the place of His presence, the holiest of holies, the place where God abides and resides, into the very presence and glory of God. His glory is that tangible, weighty, physical kabod of His presence. We can come before His presence with boldness. Amen. And in that place of His presence, we will find the newness of life. Hallelujah. And so 2019 is a church-wide shift. Now, I know pastors and preachers talk about a shift all the time, but there is a shift that is related to the virgins who realize either they had no more oil in their lamps, or in that revelation, the other virgins who realize, hey, we've got extra. There is going to be a shift that coincides with a split, and it's a shift of realization, a shift of revelation. And some, as I said, will realize that they don't have what they need, and others will realize that they do have what they need. In like manner of when I was searching God for His prophetic word, and I realized I already had it. Amen. And so some churches and some people will look to others and say, give me what you have, right? And so what will they have that some individuals and some churches will be looking for? Well, Ephesians 3:9 talks about to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. This was the word of God for us in 2017, in which I said, this is the word of fullness that starts from now until going forward. And so some are going to be looking to us for that fullness, that our lamps are full, and they're going to recognize that our lamps are full, that we're full of the knowledge of Christ, that or the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, and that we're filled with all the fullness of God. And they're also going to be looking at us by way of Hebrews 4:16. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. This is that throne of grace, that presence in the holiest of holies that I was talking about, into that place of God's glory, of His presence. And this is what I was talking about last year in 2018, where God's word for us was grace and glory, that they're going to be looking to us because we're going to be walking in the grace and favor of God, that we're going to be walking in the power and glory of God. And they're going to see that we have the boldness of faith to enter into God's glory by the grace of Jesus Christ. And finally, through God's fullness and through His grace and favor, we as the church collectively will begin the journey of being made a glorious church. It's going to be a glorious church that people are going to see the difference. Oh, because right now, if you're looking at the church, we're not looking so glorious, right? That the world is looking at us as an evil thing, a wicked thing, a thing that's against what they've decided is good and right. And they're not looking to us for answers. They're not looking to us for solutions. They're not looking for us to us for help. But because we are able to go to the throne of grace and receive that help, we're going to come to a place where we start looking like a glorious church, a place that they are drawn to. Ephesians 5:27 says it this way, that He might present to Himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. That is Jesus. When He returns, He's going to collect His bride, His church, and He's going to present to Himself a church that is a glorious church without spot or blemish or wrinkle or any such thing. And so this year will be that year where we are becoming that church without spot or wrinkle or blemish. It is a year of new life to the church. And because the church is made up of individuals, it will be new life to those of us who receive this word, who walk in this word, who hear this word, who position ourselves to walk in the life this word promises to us. Are you going to go from this day forward with just the oil, with just the anointing you've already received, separating yourself from the place where God wants you to be and left out from His power by doing your own thing, by finding your own way? Or do you want to be the church and be in the church and live a new life in power, in purpose, and prosperity from now until? It's that split. It's that time for you to decide. Are you going to prepare yourself and live your life with fresh oil, with fresh anointing, with fresh power, with fresh purpose, and with fresh prosperity? That means divine power, divine purpose, and divine prosperity. Why do I say that? Because when we compare the newness of our lives to those five wise virgins who had oil in their lamps and extra oil to spare, think about the oil in those lamps. First and foremost, that oil was fuel, and fuel had the power to light those lamps. It's a power that has the power, that adds new power to our lives. And also, not only power to light the lamp, then that means that that oil has a specific purpose to light that lamp. And there is a light in us that has a specific purpose to bring light into the darkness of this world. Amen. And so we're walking in new power. We're walking in new purpose to be the light of the world. Like scripture says, a light on a hill cannot be put under a bushel, right? No man lights a light and puts it under a bushel. But that instead, that light brings light into the darkness of the world. And then finally, that prosperity that says, you know, we need the finances and the provision and the ability to refuel, to buy extra oil. And in that sense, there's a prosperity to walk in that purpose, to a prosperity that is needed to be able to bring light into the darkness of this world. And so the choice is yours. The split is coming. Are you prepared? Are you positioning yourself to walk in the newness of life, the newness of power, of purpose, and prosperity that God has for you and for your life going forth now and until? Oh, that's a part of His glory for you. That's a part of His fullness for you. It's a part of His promise and His blessings for you as His child, His son, and His daughter. Amen. Oh, amen. If you receive it, you need to speak it. You need to declare it. You need to say it, and you need to start walking in it, walking in a church, walking in His purpose for you as a member of His church. Amen. Oh, praise God. Hallelujah and amen. That is God's prophetic word for us, His children, and His members of the house of His glory going forward in 2019. God bless you.
Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Oh, take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, well, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life. In awe of Your name, Your mighty love stands strong to the end. You will fulfill Your purpose for me. You won't forsake me, You will be with me. Here I am, God, arms wide
place now. All to Jesus now. Holding nothing back. Holding nothing back. I surrender.
Joining me for this prophetic word for 2019. Thank you for consecrating this word upon your lives as you receive it. And so now let's go into the final portion of our Melchizedek service, where I invite you to, as members, to bring your tithe into this storehouse, to show your trust in God by sowing that 10% that says that you trust Him to bless the rest. And I invite you on this first Sunday to consider sowing your first fruit offering. That first fruit is as Cain and Abel did, where they brought the first, because God says the first belongs to Him. And when we bring Him the first of all of our increase, we are trusting Him with the rest of the year, with the rest of all that we bring in, to prosper us, to increase us, to increase our territory, and to increase the fruits of our righteousness, the fruits of the good works that we are able to do for Him. Amen. And so right now at this time, as you prepare your offering, prepare to give, if you have a need in your life and you want to sow a seed towards that need, trust that God is receiving that and seeing that as your alignment with the truth of this word, of this prophetic word for your life, that you are aligning yourself with what He wants to do with this congregation and through this church and with you as an individual member of this church and the church of God collectively. Amen. And so join me in this prayer. Father God, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus Christ for all that you have for us in 2019 and going forward. Father, I ask you right now to seal this word upon our lives and our hearts, to draw us to this word and allow us to see ourselves in this word, to allow ourselves to go deeper in your word and in your truth. Allow us to draw closer to your love, to your compassion, to your concern, to your care, to draw us deeper into a more intimate, communicative, mutual relationship with you, to allow us to see your purpose in our lives, to see with clarity the big things that you want to do for us, with us, and through us, that we partnership with you, that we partner with you in our lives and in your purpose for the kingdom of God in the earth. Father, we thank you for being a loving God and for filling us with your love, for you are love. And that when we show your love in the earth, we are showing that you are alive, that you are the light of this world, and that you want to express your love to all those who do not know you. Father, strengthen us to be a witness of you and your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, teach us to walk as examples of your word. Father, thank you for every blessing of healing and provision and prosperity, righteousness and clarity, wisdom and understanding, that we might truly be as Jesus is in this world. We love you, we praise you, we glorify you. We will be ever faithful to magnify you, to lift you up, and to say glory, glory, glory unto your holy name. We pray this prayer in the mighty, matchless, glorious, perfect name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. God bless you and amen. It has been my pleasure to be your pastor in 2018, and I look forward to serving you, helping you, and growing with you in God's glory in 2019. God bless you. I love you. Continue to pray for me, and I am praying for you too. Bye-bye. Go in His glory.